Okay, so I want to talk about multi-agent pathfinding with kinematic constraints. And the problem is a very simple one. So you're given an environment, you know the environment. There's a bunch of robots that navigate in this environment. You know where they are, you know where you want them to be, and you just need to find paths that navigate them from where they are to where they should be so that the robots don't collide. And often you have some kind of an objective that you want to optimize, like, oops, good. What was that? Okay, like flow time, for example, or make span. So this kind of problem is interesting because if the robots just sort of greedily plan for their own path, in this case, right, where we had two robots on the left side that want to move to the right side, they would just both move to the right side. So eventually the violet robot will reach its goal location, will just stop there, and then the green robot can't reach its goal location any longer. So you need to plan for groups of robots. So let me press the right button here. So in this case, the violet robot needs to move into this alcove here, let the green robot pass, and off they are to the goal locations. Now, from an application perspective, this problem is really interesting because there are interesting applications that correspond to this. So at ICAPS 2014, you might remember Pete Wurman talked about the Amazon warehouses. These are automated warehouses where all of the items are stored on racks. They're stored here in the storage area. And if you order something from Amazon, like a teddy bear, for example, a robot goes into the storage area, picks up the whole rack, brings it to sort of pick and place stations. The human operator grabs it, puts it in a box, ships it to you, and then the robot takes the rack back into the storage area. Right? And that's an autonomous system. And so you can see that the storage areas have pretty narrow corridors here. So two robots can pass each other. So we have an interesting multi-agent pathfinding problem for hundreds of robots. Now, the problem that we are really interested in here is creating autonomous tug robots for aircraft. So the idea is that when an airplane lands, you want to tow it all the way from the runway to the gate to reduce pollution, energy consumption, congestion, and human workload. And again, sort of lots of planes will be towed at the same time. Planes are big, they can collide with each other. So again, we have an interesting multi-agent pathfinding problem here. Now, you have now seen sort of two pathfinding problems on real robots that we want to solve. And of course, the way we solve them in artificial intelligence is we work on abstractions of them, so we simplify them in some way. So we often use point robots. We don't really model kinematic constraints, so for example, no velocities. And we do this often in a grid world, so in a discretized environment. Now, even if we make all of these simplifying assumptions, the community knew for a long time that this is an NP-hard problem. And so there's sort of a newer result that says that, at least for mixed-span minimization, the problem remains NP-hard if you just want to be bounded suboptimal for a small suboptimality factor. So these are hard problems. But of course, we in AI, we always solve hard problems, so that doesn't deter us much. And in this case, these abstractions that we are working on are really helpful because they often make the structure of these problems more obvious. That helps us to exploit the structure. And so we have algorithms now that perform well in cluttered and tight environments for sort of hundreds of robots. And they give you theoretical guarantees. They're bounded suboptimal. They don't quite work in real time, so you need maybe for 200 plus robots, maybe sort of 20 seconds or 30 seconds. But we are getting there. So these algorithms become more and more powerful. There's a ton of them. You know, you have to look into the paper, the related work section. Lots of people have worked on this. The algorithm that we want to use here is sort of a marriage of two algorithms. We call it conflict-based search with highways. It's the idea of a conflict-based search. That comes from Ariel Ferner's group. We use a bounded suboptimal version of this, and then basically it plans for each agent independently, and then if it turns out that two agents A and B collide in cell X at time t, then it imposes a disjunctive constraint, namely that agent A and agent B cannot both be in cell X at time t, right? And then it figures out how to do that using heuristic search. It's a good algorithm. Now, we were worried about scaling this up further, and we also wanted to achieve consistency of motion. And that's often a good, if humans look at robots operating, gives you sort of a better idea of what they're doing in case they're sort of your co-workers. And so we came up with this idea that we wanted to impose one-way streets for these robots. So the idea is that if you have one-way streets that the robots move along, then there can't be any head-to-head collisions of the robots any longer. And if you reduce the number of collisions, that makes conflict-based search faster. Now, how do we do it? And here, so we got very lucky because Mike Phillips will talk a little bit later on e-graphs. So we use this idea from him that he has done in the context of single-agent search. So he has figured out how to do bounded suboptimal single-agent search so that the resulting path uses edges in a given subgraph. In our case, these are these one-way streets as much as possible. But you can also deviate in order to guarantee the suboptimality bound. Now, the way how these highways look like for us, so here's sort of, again, sort of an Amazon warehouse type example. You just look at the east-west corridors, the red edges here, these would be the highways, the one-way streets. So here, for example, we want robots to go from left to right, next one from right to left, and so on. And so by putting these two techniques that I just talked about together, we can decrease the planning effort, we can provide quality guarantees because they're both bounded suboptimal, so we get something, again, that's bounded suboptimal. And even if the highways, if some human designer, for example, designs the wrong highways, the problem remains always solvable, no matter what the highways are. But it's more efficient if the highways are good. So there's a little bit better algorithm now out there that we'll present at Itch.Guy, but we'll go with this one for now. Now, the problem that we have in our group, and I think that's how many people here think as well, is that, you know, when we are given an optimization problem, we develop better and better algorithms for this optimization problem, but we very seldomly stop and ask ourselves, you know, is that sort of the right problem to solve? And if we really need to do this on robots, you know, how do we actually do that? So that's basically what this paper here is all about. One of the issues here is that planning has to use models, and these models will never be completely accurate. So in our case, for example, in these simplifications for these multi-agent pathfinding problems, you know, we assume that the robots are completely synchronized, that they move in lockstep at exactly the nominal speeds. We don't model the kinematic constraints. We don't worry about the velocities and so on. And of course, in practice, right, these assumptions are not quite justified. So therefore, plan execution will likely deviate from the plan. Now, the answer that we often have in AI is that we say, well, you know, when there's some deviation from the plan, we just replan. Right? If replan worked really well, so why don't we just do that? But there are lots of problems with this. In particular here, one of the problems is that we're solving an NP-hard problem, so we are already stressing the solvers you know, to cope with more and more agents, so we can't go in and every second say, you know, we need to replan. That just don't work. So what do we do about it? And so here's sort of the executive summary of the talk. So it's about an approach, a novel approach that we call MapFPost. And it makes use of a simple temporal network to post-process the output of a multi-agent pathfinding solver from AI. It does that very quickly, definitely in polynomial time, to allow for plan execution on robots. It can take into account that edges have different lengths. That's also something that in AI the solvers often don't do. It can take into account velocity limits, that robots can move faster than a given speed, but also that you might want to impose speed limits in part of the terrain just for safety. They guarantee a safety distance between robots and also avoids replanning in many cases. You can always avoid it, but in many cases we can. So let's figure out how this particular approach works. So we can use any map solver, MapF solver. It produces a MapF plan, and that's an input to this MapF post approach. So the MapF post approach then directs the robots. So for every robot, it's a centralized approach at this point. It sends the robot a direction and a velocity, how to move. It then gets back the locations of the robot, so it can figure out whether robots deviate from the plan. If so, It tries to handle that internally by updating the directions and velocities of the robots. If it figures out that it can't do that, then it might go to the MapF solver and request a new plan from the MapF solver. Okay, so let's look at our example here again, same example as before. I'll give you sort of a brief walkthrough through all of the high-level steps. I don't give you a whole lot of details, but of course they're in the paper. So here's the multi-agent pathfinding problem that we want to solve. The first thing that we do is we discretize it. So here's the discretization, a nice graph. So when robots move on this graph, and they move in lockstep on this graph, that also means that the arrival times into these locations are discretized, right? The robot can now arrive at a location times of 1 or 2 or 3 or 4. It's no longer continuous. So now we feed the discretized problem into a multi-agent pathfinding solver. Out pops a plan. That's the plan that we have seen before. And so in addition to all of the arrival times into these locations being discretized, they're also now totally ordered, right? Because the MapF solver says robot 1 at time step 1 will arrive in that particular location. So what we're doing now is we need wiggle room, right, to address this problem that if plan execution deviates from the plan, we need to do something about it. And we get the wiggle room by relaxing these two things. So arrival times will no longer be discretized and also will no longer be totally ordered. So how do we do it? It's pretty easy. So we construct a graph. We call it a precedence graph. Can do this quickly. The vertices correspond to events of robots arriving at locations, and the edges correspond to temporal precedences between these events. So for our example, so it takes as input the discretized environment and the plan. This here is the temporal plan graph. The top row corresponds to agent 1 or robot 1. The bottom row is robot 2. And so this corresponds to robot starting in location A, moving to B, C, D, and E. Second robot starting in B, moving to C, F, C, and D. Now the blue edges here, they correspond to the order in which the same robot arrives at locations. Right? Robot 1 starts at location A and then moves into B. The green edges here correspond to the order in which two different robots arrive at the same location. So for example, robot 2 starts in B, and only afterwards can robot 1 move to location B. Okay, so that's the precedence graph. I think you can see that we can get this very quickly out of the inputs. So then the next thing that we do is we augment it with additional vertices that we call safety markers. These are the small circles in our case. And so the idea is that the safety markers correspond to locations. And these are locations that are at some distance delta, some parameter away from the main locations that we think about. So here's the safety marker. This is the main location A here. And then we change these type 2 edges, the green ones in the previous slide, to go from safety marker to safety marker. And the reason why we do that is simple. So now basically what we're seeing is that robot 2 has to have left location B and reached the safety marker behind it before robot 1 enters B by reaching the safety marker in front of it. So you can see that this will give us safety distances and deconflict these robots. So this is really important, of course, because robots really have extent, right? Always assume that they are point robots, but they aren't. So we need to have these safety distances. Okay, so now that we have the augmented temporal plan graph, now what we'll do is we'll convert that into a simple temporal network. So standard construct in artificial intelligence for temporal reasoning, right, where the vertices correspond to events, the edges correspond to temporal precedences between events, but now we also have these bounds here, lower and upper bound, and so all that says is that this event here can take place only between 4 and infinity time units after this event, right? So in our case, it means that robot 2 can reach this safety marker only between 4 and infinity seconds after reaching location B, where do we get these numbers from? Well, we know maximum velocities for the robots. They can move infinitely fast. And so we can just take the edge length divided by the maximum velocity. We can figure out that the robot needs 4 seconds, right, to traverse that particular edge. So it can arrive here only 4 seconds after it has arrived here. So maximum velocities give us lower bounds, and similarly, minimum velocities will give us upper bounds. There are none here, but they will show up in a second, so keep this in mind. So now all we need to do is we need to find arrival times into all of these locations that are consistent with the constraints. And of course, you know, we in the AI community have studied this. So in our case, what we do is we find the earliest arrival times in all of these locations that are consistent with the constraints, because that minimizes flow time and makes them, you know, at the same time. So it works well for us. We just use standard techniques, so we can use graph-based optimization, right, finding the shortest path on the distance graph. That's really fast, or a little bit slower, but still polynomial time, right? We can just use linear programming. So we minimize the sum of the arrival times, you know, subject to the arrival time satisfying the lower and upper bounds of all of these intervals. Now, I mentioned earlier that the robots really have extent. There are no point robots. And so we need to worry about this a little bit, because we haven't really taken this into account yet. But it turns out that this is easy, and that's sort of the technical contribution of this particular paper. So if you assume that every robot moves with constant velocity between some minimum and some maximum velocity along every type 1 edge, then you can figure out, and that takes sort of a page of proof, that the graph-based safety distance between any two robots is this. So it's 2 delta times the minimum velocity over maximum velocity. Remember, delta was just how far the safety markers away from the main locations. So this is a little bit tricky. I'm very slightly fudging here. Details, of course, are in the paper here. But once you have figured this out, then you can just maximize the minimum velocity to maximize the safety distance. And again, you can do that using linear programming. Looks like as before, except that now you maximize the minimum velocity. And now we have minimum velocities. They give us upper bounds, right? And so you just add the upper bound constraints to the constraints that we had before, right? So now you just solve this RP again. You can do that in polynomial time. And it's certainly very, very fast compared to MEPF solving. So here's how the approach then comes together. So for a given MEPF plan, we construct a simple temporal network. If it's not solvable, we need to go to the planner and get a new plan. But if it is solvable, then we have arrival times at all of these locations. We can use them just to determine the speeds with which these robots should move in order to arrive at the right time. We can send this to the robots. And then if plan execution deviates from the plan, we repeat, right? So we reconstruct the simple temporal network. If it's still solvable, we do not need to replan. And rather, we can keep executing the plan with new velocities. Okay, good. So experiments. We have done experiments, both in simulation, in VRAP as robot simulator, as well as on iRobot Create 2 robots in an environment that was fitted with the Vicon motion capture system so that we have ground truth. This is the right time to mention that this is a collaboration between an AI lab and a robotics lab. And Nora Ayanian is here somewhere over here, so we're both here. And rather than going through the experiments, given that I'm running out of time, I'll just show you sort of the nice video here. Let me sort of start this video, and then I will conclude immediately afterwards. And one of the things that you can see in this small thing is that the robots really do move at slightly different distances. Sometimes they get close and so on. So we need to have these safety distances in sort of a planned monitoring approach like this. And of course, you know, in simulation, we have done much, much larger examples as well. So here are the conclusions. So we have this nice way of doing plan execution monitoring and sort of avoiding this very expensive pre-planning. It can do a bunch of things. And you notice that kinematic constraints is in the title, right? But for this paper, kinematic constraints just means velocities, right? Adjusting velocities. There's more to it. We don't worry about accelerations, for example. And so it's a good first approach. we view this approach as we're very excited about it, right? Because we feel that AI planners are very powerful. So we feel that robotics people should really use them. And that gives us sort of a good systematic, sort of a non-ad hoc way of bridging this gap between planning that uses a model that doesn't quite fit reality. But then again, it's just the first approach. We have future work cut out for us to make this more realistic. So some of these things are listed here. But we'll work full speed on this in the future. With this, let me conclude. Thank you for giving me the extra half a minute.
So,